Hi, I'm Dr. Pooja Mishra, and the topic of my presentation is polarimetry concepts and applications in land cover monitoring. And in this lecture, we'll see the basic concepts of SAR polarimetry and its application in land cover monitoring. This SAR polarimetry stands for Synthetic Aperture Radar Polarimetry. So now let's see what is synthetic aperture radar polarimetry. It is the merging of two technological concepts called radar and the polarimetry. Radar stands for radio detection and ranging, and the polarimetry is the science of measuring orientation and shape. And this property of radio wave is caused due to the fundamental nature of transverse electromagnetic field. Because of the time varying nature of electromagnetic field, the tip of electric field vector traces an ellipse in a plane perpendicular to the direction of propagation. So when the electromagnetic wave enters into a medium having different refractive index, the polarization property of this electromagnetic wave is transformed. This polarization transformation behavior of electromagnetic wave is known as polarimetry. So what radar does? In radar system we have an antenna which is used to send this transmitted signal, and upon being reflected from an object, a reflected signal is returned back to the radar signal. So this received radar signal provides information about the properties of scatterers on the ground. It observes the strength and time delay of the return signal and characterizes the object on the basis of its signal strength. So why we use this synthetic aperture radar? In conventional radar system, it was imaging radar, which was known as real aperture radar. In this type of radar, in conventional radar system, what happens, there was single antenna which was used for transmission and reception of electromagnetic signal, and this antenna was fixed. So the radar returns which were received through the antenna were capturing only the amplitude of the returned echoes from the ground object. Because we have only amplitude of the returned echo from the object, there were limited information that we could receive with the help of real aperture radar. This is the radar system in which the antenna is sending the waves toward the earth surface. This direction is called as a range direction, and this direction is called azimuth direction. So another disadvantage of this real aperture radar system was the poor azimuth resolution. The definition of this azimuth resolution is, the formula is lambda r by t, where r is the distance from the antenna to the ground object and d is the length of this antenna or the aperture of this antenna. Since this azimuth resolution is dependent on the lambda r and d, so in order to improve the azimuth resolution, what one can do, one can reduce the wavelength or increase the length of the antenna. We cannot reduce the distance between the antenna and the earth surface. So what we could do, we can increase the reduce the wavelength, or we could use shorter wavelength pulses. But the problem with the shorter wavelength pulses is that they are affected by the atmospheric attenuation. They'll be affected by rain, cloud and several other attenuations happening in the atmosphere, and the it will reduce the all weather capability of the radar. And second thing is, we can improve the resolution by increasing the antenna dimension. But there is a limit by which we can increase the antenna dimension. We cannot use very large antenna, which will not be practically feasible. So the concept of SAR came into picture. So now, what is SAR? In SAR system, we increase the antenna length synthetically, and length means aperture here. We increase the antenna aperture by synthetically by moving the antenna over a platform called spacecraft, and by which we synthesize a large antenna. So small antenna can be synthesized electronically into the larger antenna, and since it is a moving system, it measures both amplitude and phase. So we are receiving multidimensional information because it is measuring various polarizations, and for each polarization it is measuring both amplitude and phase. So this multidimensional information that we receive through synthetic aperture radar is very helpful in resolving the ambiguity about the source of scattering from various objects. And also it has the higher resolution, and the larger range can be covered for imaging the Earth's surface. So the azimuth resolution of this SAR is D by 2. D is the dimension of this antenna. So azimuth resolution is, you can see, is independent of the distance between object and the sensor, R. And what we are seeing here, that lesser the antenna size, the better will be the resolution. But we cannot reduce the size to very minimum, because there is also a limit for the minimum size of this antenna for imaging purpose. So now let's see what radar does. As we saw, that radar means antenna is sending the signal towards the Earth's surface, and the backscattered information, this is backscattered information which is received by the antenna. So radar reflectivity is a backscattered signal of a target as a function of their position. So this SAR image, this is the mini SAR image of Peary crater, which is shown over here. So each pixel represents radar reflectivity or the backscattered signal. Now what is backscattered ratio or backscatter coefficient? Normalized radar cross section backscattering coefficient is given by this formula. Sigma naught is equal to 10 log energy ratio. This energy ratio is the ratio of the energy received by the sensor to the energy reflected in isotropic manner. Isotropic means in all the direction equally. So this backscatter coefficient is different for different types of object, depending upon their material properties, depending upon their shape, depending upon their roughness, etc. So the backscatter coefficient will be positive. The backscatter wave is focused towards the radar. The backscatter signal that will return back to the radar, if it is focused toward the radar, then this backscattering coefficient will be positive, because the energy received by the sensor will be more. However, when the energy is focused away from the radar, this is the direction of radar wave, in this direction the antenna should be existing, while if energy is reflected away from the radar signal, the backscatter coefficient will be negative or very low. This type of phenomena occurs through the smooth surface. Now what is SAR image? This is Sentinel-1 SAR image of Kerala region, and what does this SAR image represent? The SAR image represents the physical process. Each pixel in this SAR image is a measurement representing the backscattering coefficient, and this backscattering coefficient is related to the physical process associated with each land cover time. So if you want to interpret this SAR image, you should understand very well the physical processes associated with the radar interaction and different land cover. So if you know the physical process, then the SAR image could be interpreted very well. So what is the motivation of using this SAR image for Earth observation? So let's see. This SAR image provides complementary information to the optical sensor. I'm not saying here that optical sensor is bad and the SAR sensor is very good here, but both are complementary to each other. Some information is very well obtained with the help of optical image, and sometimes we get good information with the help of SAR image. Both are complementary to each other. This is the optical image, Sentinel-2 image of Prayagraj, or you could say Allahabad region. This is Ganga and Yamuna river, and this is the Prayagraj city. This is vegetation lying in the on different land covers, and this is urban area. You see in optical image, these areas appears black. This is black, this is black, this is black, and water is black in both. This is river. Prayagraj has two river, Ganga, Yamuna, and Saraswati is invisible. This region is the city region, which is quite bright in this SAR image. If you see, this is quite bright in this SAR image. You are very well able to distinguish this urban area through SAR image than in optical image. Also, what you are observing here, this is this line that you are seeing, observing over here. These are the bridges over this river, which is not quite visible. There is line here, but it is not quite visible in this area. If you see clearly, this is visible in SAR image. You cannot distinguish it well in this optical image. Also here, this region is visible over here, while you cannot distinguish this region in the optical image. So both are complementary to each other. There are some information related to agriculture are very well obtained through optical images, and some information we get very well through SAR image, because we are obtaining information at different wavelengths and polarization, so we receive more information from SAR image. Another advantage of using SAR image for Earth observation is their capability to operate in day and night. So it is an active sensor which makes use of its own illuminating system, that is antenna, for illuminating the Earth's surface. It can work well in day and night. However, what happens in optical data, if it is a night time, it cannot produce an image. It is dependent on the sunlight, and we are able to image the Earth's surface day and night through SAR sensors. Another thing is that is very good in SAR is the penetration capability. Since it is a microwave signal, and it works from 1 millimeter to 1 meter wavelength, we can obtain information beneath the ground from the microwave image. So the soil moisture information and the information below the ice, etc., could be received very well with the help of SAR image. However, this information we cannot receive through optical image. Also, because we are measuring both amplitude and phase, this multidimensional information is helpful in obtaining various characteristics like geometrical properties of the target, shape, orientation, etc. of the target could be very well received by, obtained by the SAR image. And you see the image over here, different types of scatterer respond differently to different polarization. So the information received from different object or the backscattering ratio will be different for different types of object. Like you see here, the water surface is producing very less return, while the some backscattering is occurring from forest and rough surface. So the backscattering coefficient will be different for different types of polarization and different types of incidence angle. So we could receive much more information through the SAR image by making use of various frequencies, polarizations, and incidence angle. The shape, symmetry, orientation, etc. of the target can also be very well determined. So now let's first see the polarization. What is polarization? Because it is polarimetry, and which is dependent on the polarization. So polarization is the property of transverse nature of electromagnetic wave, and because of this time varying nature of electromagnetic wave, ellipse is formed in a plane perpendicular to the direction of propagation. This is electric field which is resolved into two component. Here please see, we are considering the wave propagation in z direction. So we have two components, ex and ey, and the phase related to this x and y component is delta x and delta y. If we solve these equations, the ellipse equation will be obtained in general, and based on the value of this delta x and delta y and eox and eoy, we can obtain various other types of polarization. So this polarization ellipse is like this. There are several parameters associated with this polarization ellipse. The first one is wave amplitude, which is a under root eox square plus eoy square. Phi is the orientation angle, which is the angle between the major axis and the x-axis and the major axis of the ellipse. Its value ranges from minus pi by 2 to pi by 2, and the ellipticity angle is the angle between the major axis and the minor axis, and its value ranges from 0 to pi by 4. These value determines which type of polarization will be there, what will be the sense of polarization, will it be left polarized or right polarized, will be determined on the basis of these parameters. So on the basis of this phase difference between x and y component, there are three kinds of polarization. The first one is linear polarization. Linear polarization occurs when delta, the difference between the x and y component phase difference, is zero. It is linear polarization. Linear means either horizontal polarization or a vertical polarization. Okay, now circular polarization, when the phase difference between x and y component is multiple of pi by 2 and the eox is equal to eoy, it will be a circular polarization. And elliptical polarization is in general. This is linear 45 and linear minus 45, depending upon the value of orientation and ellipticity angle. So how do we decide this left hand and right hand polarization? So you need to take your left hand and point your thumb in the direction of propagation, which is z direction, away from this screen, and you move your finger. If you have to move your finger by moving the leading component towards the lagging component, and you need to use your left hand finger, it is left hand polarization. Otherwise it will be a right hand polarization. Okay, so the polarization, the satellites which are mostly available now are in linear polarization. That is, they have two components, either H or either H or V or both. So suppose we have all four combinations related to H and V. So the polarizations that we could get is HH, HV, VH and VV. HH stands for horizontal transmit and horizontal receive. First term represents transmission, second represents reception. Horizontal transmit, vertical receive. Vertical transmit, horizontal receive. Vertical transmit, vertical receive. So in VV, what happens? Radar sends vertically polarized signal towards the earth, and upon the reception, vertically signal is received. This is VV. In HH, what happens? We are sending H signal and horizontal polarization is received by the antenna through the horizontal filter. In HV, we send horizontal signal and reception is done in vertical polarization. So HH and VV are called this HH and VV because same polarization is used for transmission and reception. They are called like polarization or co-polarization, and HV and VH are called cross polarization channel. Each polarization describes different scattering property from different objects. So we'll see later the effect of this polarization over this lecture. So now let's move on to scattering polarimetry. In geoscience applications, some targets are there which are deterministic or single target. Single target or deterministic or time invariant target. So when the information electromagnetic signal is sent from the radar, the receive signal is obtained, which is called scattered signal, and the scattered and incident waves are related by this equation, Es is equal to exponential minus jkr by r s into ei. and this S is called scattering matrix. In general, if we use all four polarization combinations, exponential minus jkr by r represents the propagation effect in both amplitude and phase, and this scattering matrix information, it describes the characteristics of the observed area. It describes how the scatterer transforms the incident vector into the scattered vector. And this type of information, scattering information, is received from completely polarized targets or deterministic target. If there is a single target, the information received will be in the form of scattering matrix. However, in most geoscience applications, the scatterers are not a single target or not deterministic target. They are embedded in the dynamic environment. You see, this is the general case in which scatterers are randomly oriented over the earth surface. Let's say, like there are trees, buildings, and so many things lying over there randomly. So there is not a single target. There are various targets which are embedded in dynamic environment, and they are affected by spatial and time variation. They are changing with respect to either time or with respect to space, like motion of water, vegetation growth, sometimes deforestation is there. So changes are occurring continuously. These scatterers are embedded in dynamic environment. So this type of targets are called distributed scatterers or the partial scatterers. If you want to get the information through the radar about these types of scatterers, you cannot use the scattering coefficient. It will not be useful here because it will give you the information about the point target. However, what happens when these distributed scatterers are there and the radar is sending the signal over the Earth's surface, then in each resolution cell is the area in which one beam is sent by the radar signal. So in each resolution cell, the scatterers are changing over time or space. There are different number of scatterers in each resolution cell. So because of this time varying nature, we cannot use the scattering matrix, because the electric field vector obtained for these types of scatterer will not trace in perfect ellipse. So the information about these scatterers could be obtained only when we take the statistical averaging of the information received from these scatterers over time. So we need to use some second order statistics here, not the first order statistic, that is scattering matrix. So how do we get this second order statistics? Let's see it over here. So polarimetric scattering problem can be represented by the vectorial formation of the S scattering matrix. What happens here is we have this polarimetric data which is in the form of scattering matrix here. This is scattering matrix, and then we perform the vectorization. What is the purpose here? We need to create the second order statistics here. So this is done through the vectorization of S. The vectorization of S is done by using a trace of S with some basis sets, so that we get the information in the form of some vectors. There are two basis sets which are used in general in geoscience application. The first one is lexicographic basis and the second is Pauli basis. Lexicographic basis is defined in terms of scattering vectors directly, and Pauli basis is the combination of the scattering vectors. Like this is 1, 1, 1 and 1. Here we have 1, 1 for two diagonal elements, 1, minus 1 in two diagonal elements. This will give you the combination of scattering terms. So after performing the vectorization, trace means summation of diagonal element. Here the trace is written, which is the sum of diagonal element. The performing of vectorization through of S will give you two vectors. One is lexicographic scattering vector, and another one is Pauli scattering vector. Lexicographic is indirectly in terms of scattering terms SHH, SVH, SHV, and SVV, and Pauli is in terms of summation or difference of these scattering terms. So how do we get this second order statistics through this scattering matrix? By taking the inner product of these lexicographic and Pauli scattering vectors. So this will give you a 3 cross 3 matrix, which is a second order statistics of scattering terms. So first one is covariance matrix. This is represented by C, which is defined as the statistical average of the inner product of lexicographic vectors. KL is the lexicographic vector, and this sign represents the statistical averaging. So the coherency matrix for backscatter condition, when SHV is equal to SH, SHV is equal to SVH, represents the backscatter condition, so that we get the 3 cross 3 matrix. Otherwise we will get the 4 cross 4 matrix here. This is covariance matrix, and this another matrix is called coherency matrix. This is coherency matrix, which is obtained by taking the inner product of the Pauli scattering vector and taking the spatial averaging of these two vectors will eventually give you the coherency matrix. All both these matrices are almost same. They give you information about various scattering terms. This is directly in terms of system measurables, that is SHH, SHV, and SVV, while this coherency matrix is in the terms of is in the form of the terms which are directly related to the physical or geometrical properties of the target. Like this term will represent double bounce, this will represent single bounce scattering, and this term, this is SHV square, will give you the information related to volume scattering. So based on the polarizations sent by the radar system, there are various types of polarimetric modes, single polarized mode, double polarized mode, quad polarimetric mode, and the hybrid polarimetric mode. In single polarimetric mode, we used to send the same information same polarization and receive in same polarization. So we'll have either HH or VV. Dual polarization will have will send one polarization and receive two polarizations coherently. So it will be either HH or HV, or it will be VH or VV. Okay, so in quad polarization will send two polarizations and receive another two polarizations coherently. So we'll have four terms that will receive through this quad polarized term. Another polarimetry is the hybrid polarimetry, which makes use of the circular polarization also, and along with the linear polarization. So in this type of polarimetry, we either send the right hand or left hand circular polarization and receive horizontal and vertical simultaneously. So let's see how these modes work. This is a single polarization system in which there is single antenna which is transmitting horizontal and receiving horizontal direction. So let's see what happens during transmission. We have horizontal polarization which is sent through antenna, and we are receiving the horizontal polarization. So in one resolution cell, we'll receive the component called SHH here. Similarly, we could do the similar thing for VV polarization if it would be a VV polarized system. In dual polarization system, what will happen? We are sending the horizontally polarized signal as an incident wave, and we are receiving horizontal and vertical polarization simultaneously. So we'll have two types of scattering components, which will be Now for this combination H and H will get SHH, and for this combination H and V will get SHV. Okay, so this will happen for each PRFs. Next is quad polarity matrix. Three polarity matrix system, because it obtains information in all possible combinations of the polarization. So what happens in this quad polarity matrix system? During the transmission, we send the horizontal and vertical pulses and receive the horizontal and vertical simultaneously. Suppose in first part, we are sending the horizontal pulse and receiving the horizontal and vertical simultaneously. So for this part, we'll get SHH and SHV. Next, we'll send the vertical polarized signal and receive the horizontal and vertical simultaneously, which will give you SVH and SVV. So this will give you the whole scattering matrix SHH, SHV, SVH and SVV. This is fully polarity matrix system. Next is compact polarity matrix system, which makes use of both circular and linear polarizations. So in this type of polarization, either right hand R represent right, L represent, if it would be a left hand polarized system, it would be L written over here. So, but here I am representing right hand circular polarization. So let's see, we are sending the right hand circularly polarized signal during transmission and receiving the horizontal and vertically polarized waves coherently. So this will give you ERH and ERV. Here the information that is received is in the form of ERH and ERV, and will receive both amplitude and the phase for these ERH and ERV. And the final product that will be obtained from the compact dual polarity matrix system will be in the form of Stokes vector. This is Stokes vector, which is obtained by making use of ERH and ERV. So G naught is the first Stokes vector, which is equal to ERH square plus ERV square. G1 is the second Stokes vector, which is equal to ERH square minus ERV square. G2 is the third Stokes vector, which is equal to twice of real ERH ERV conjugate. G3 is equal to minus 2 imaginary part ERH ERV conjugate. It is a very useful parameter, and it is used in various satellite systems. This polarimetry is used in various satellite, like in MINISAR, which for Chandrayaan 1, MINISAR 2, RISAT 1. Various products are available in this format. In a compact quad polarity matrix system, what happens? Transmitter sends right hand circular polarization and receive horizontal and vertical coherently, and will get ERH, ERV. And in second part, the left hand circular depolarized signal is sent, and horizontal and vertically polarized signals are received coherently. So we get ELH and ELV. So the information is received like this. Now let's see the scattering mechanisms. Now what we have seen till now, that we are sending the signal in one polarization and receiving the transformed version of polarization from different types of targets. So this is SAR polarimetry. What happens when the electromagnetic signal is sent towards the Earth's surface? There is an object, and after reflection, this transformation behavior, this polarization is transformed upon reflection. This polarization transformation behavior is known as SAR polarimetry. So what we are observing here is the scattering information, the backscattered information from different targets through the polarimetric behavior. So now let's see what is the scattering mechanisms that are associated with various types of target and how they are affecting various polarizations. So first type of scattering is the direct backscattering. In direct backscattering, when the signal is sent towards the target and it reflects directly towards the radar again, this is direct backscattering. This will produce high copolarization ratio. These types of target appear very bright in the SAR image. Which target? Which are oriented perpendicular to the direction of propagation of signal. These types of target produce direct scattering, and the copolarization ratio is very strong from these types of target. If we use short radar wavelength like C band, then the leaves of canopy will also produce direct scattering. They will also appear bright in C band images. Next type of scattering is the single bounce scattering. When the transmitted signal is reflected once on the surface and continues its path away from the SAR antenna. So the radar return towards the radar itself is very less from these types of target. What type of target? Like smooth surface or bare soil surface, calm water, they represent single bounce scattering. Means there is only single reflection from these type of surfaces. So they will appear dark since there is very less reflection that will be received by the antenna. So these types of target will be represented dark in both copolarization and cross-polarization types of images. Like this. This is L band pulsar image of city Roorkee, which is in Uttarakhand in India. This is the city where IIT Roorkee exists. In these images, you see the black portion here, this line. You see, this line is the canal. It is water which appears black in all three images. Okay, so the smooth surface represents specular scattering or the single bounce scattering, and the region appears dark in both in all types of images. This area is ground, this area is ground, not the water. This is also appeared black in all three images. So these areas produce single bounce scattering, that's why they appear black in all the images, all types of polarization. Second scattering is double bounce scattering. When double bounce will occur? When the target and the ground surface are perpendicular to each other, then what happens? The signal sent by the radar is reflected twice, once by this ground and once by this perpendicular surface. So the signal received towards the radar is enhanced. So these type of targets appear bright in image. From which type of target will get this type of scattering? From grass and tree cuts, from buildings, or any two perpendicular surfaces will give you double bounce scattering. Usually, the urban area will appear bright in SAR images. You see in all these images, this is the again, I'm showing this image. This is of city Roorkee, and this is city area. The bright portion here is the city area which appears bright in all these images, this and this, which appears bright. And this is C band VV image of Allahabad. This is VV image of Allahabad, Sentinel-1 image of Allahabad. And you see, this is Prayagraj city, and the area which are bright over here are city region, which appear bright in this. Next is volume scattering, which occurs when the radar signal subject is subjected to multiple reflections because of the roughness of target or the type of target. Like from tree, when the signal is sent towards tree to the tree, there will be multiple reflections from the tree branches, leaves, etc. Or if there are ice deposits within the subsurface, then there will be multiple reflections occurring through the ice deposit. So these types of object will give you volume scattering or the diffuse scattering, and the scattering signal is scattered in multiple directions. So they will also appear bright in HV image. So this is HV image. This is volume scattering, which is shown in HV image, which appears bright in all these images. This is vegetation region, which appears grayish type of region, and it is volume scattering, which is shown over here in this image, Sentinel-1 image of Kerala. Now let's see how radar wave interacts with the various types of targets lying over the earth surface. And this radar wave interaction depends on two types of parameter. The first type of parameter is system parameter, and second is target parameter. The system parameter means the parameters which are used in radar system that are controlling its operation. These parameters are polarization, frequency, and the incidence angle or the look angle. Target parameters are related to geometrical structure, means size, shape, orientation, surface roughness of the target, and the dielectric property, means the dielectric constant. You see, these effects we have seen already. Different types of target are producing different types of scattering. Sometimes urban appears bright, calm water appears dark. The electric properties for different types of target having they have different types of dielectric property. Like water has the dielectric constant 80, and some dry soil will have the dielectric constant 3. So higher dielectric constant targets will produce dark appearance in a SAR image, and they will, and the lighter dielectric constant will somewhat lighter in this SAR image. So let's see the effect of this radar wave on polarization, frequency, and the incidence angle. So first we'll see the effect of polarization. This is the RGB composite image of Pulsar, which is L band data of city of Roorkee in Uttarakhand, in which this radar composite composed of HH, HV and VV as red, green and red, blue and green respectively. You see the green over here in city of Roorkee, which represents the volume scattering. HV enhances the volume scattering, HH enhances the dihedral or double bounce scattering, and VV enhances the single bounce scattering. So wherever we'll see the blue means we are having single bounce scattering dominant from that target. Now first let's understand the three types of scattering that we saw earlier. We cannot get the single type of scattering from any single target. The reflection that is obtained from the target lying over the earth surface represents the combination of scattering, because all the targets are distributed over the surface and they are varying with respect to time and space. So the scattering information that is received from the land cover is the combination of scattering. Only what happens, only one type of scattering will be dominant for one particular type of land cover. So the green that we observe over here represents that volume scattering. This is the first hand analysis, not the final analysis. The first hand analysis says, the visual interpretation says that this urban area represents the volume scattering as a dominant component here. All types of scattering will be present over here, but the dominant part is HV. in this area. This pink part, this is the area where IIT Roorkee exists, and this is the ground of IIT Roorkee, which appears black, and we are having pink in this IIT Roorkee region. Pink is the combination of HH and VV, means we'll have the combination of this dihedral scattering and the single bound scattering. Similarly, other colors would be interpreted for different types of land covers. So the final is here that specular scattering from the water is black in all three types of polarization. HV is quite brighter in HV, urban is quite brighter in HV polarized image. This is Solani River, which is which was dry at the time of acquisition, and this because it was dry, there was no moisture in it. As I said, since it is a dry, it will have dielectric constant around 3-4 etc. So it is appeared bright in this VV polarized image, which enhances the single bounce scattering. Okay, and now let's see the effect of frequency or wavelength. How the frequency will affect the radar interaction? Frequency is related to wavelength. Lambda is equal to C by F. So higher the frequency, lower will be the wavelength, or lower the frequency, higher the wavelength. So if you want to obtain information beneath the vegetation, then you need to use longer wavelength so that the electromagnetic signal that is sent towards the earth surface can penetrate below the earth surface. Okay, and if you want to obtain the information about the tree canopy, then you need not to use this higher wavelength signal. You can use the images which have the low wavelength. So low wavelength signal means higher frequency signals will give you only the surface related information. They cannot penetrate deeply into the surface, so they will give you only the upper surface information, while as the frequency is becomes lower, the wavelength becomes high, and you will be able to get the information beneath the surface that you are observing. So different types of frequencies are used for obtaining the information from different types of scatterers. Like X band will give you the information related to leaves and twigs. It is 8 to 12 gigahertz. C band will give you information related to small branches. L band will give you scattering from branches, stems also, or if it is a bare soil surface, it will give you the information beneath the ground also. P band will give you the information scattering from the large branches, stems, or beneath the ground. There are various satellites available now, and some are coming in future, and P band is the biomass satellite. L band, which are available right now, is ALOS 2, Pulsar 2, SAUCOM will come in near future, NISAR will come in near future, S band, NOVASAR and NISAR-S, C band, Sentinel 1 is available right now. Set radar set 2 and RCM, X band, TerraSAR X, Tandem X, Cosmo SkyMet signal. So all are operating in different frequencies. Depending upon your applications and requirement, you may choose any type of satellite data. Now the rule of thumb here is which type of wavelength or the frequency you should use. If you want to resolve a target, any particular target according to your application, then the rule of thumb is the radar wavelength should be of the order of spatial magnitude of illuminated object. Then radar will be able to see that object very clearly. Otherwise, what will happen, that object, if the radar wavelength is small compared to the object, then that type of object will appear transparent to the radar. So different types of frequencies are used for different applications. C band is used for ocean and agriculture. L band is used for agriculture, forestry and soil moisture because it can penetrate deeply into the ground. P band will also be able to get the information about the soil moisture. And the higher frequencies are used for glaciology snow cover mapping. KU band data is used for snow cover mapping. Now see the effect of incidence angle on various targets. It represents the angle between the incident radar beam, this is incident radar beam, and the direction perpendicular to the ground surface. For some application, low incidence angle is very good, while for some the higher incidence angle is good. And this incidence angle determines how the object will appear in SAR image. Returns due to surface scattering are usually strong at low incidence angle, and these returns decrease with increasing incidence angle. And the returns due to volume scattering from heterogeneous medium are usually more uniform for all types of incidence angle. So it decides the appearance of various objects on SAR image. Now where the source of confusion lies in this SAR image, you can see wherever we have open water and low vegetation, they will appear almost same in SAR image. Like one of the example here, it is the image of Roorkee. This is the ground which appears black in this image, and this is also a ground surface, this red part, and the water appears black. So see the open water which is canal region here, and the ground which has grass or low vegetation also appears black in SAR image. So there are certain sources of confusion which would lead to development of several advanced algorithms for discrimination of these types of targets from the SAR images. So there are various land cover monitoring methods which are target identification or target decomposition methods, classification methods, and surface parameter retrieval method. What are the surface parameter that we could retrieve from the SAR image? They are soil moisture, dielectric constant, etc. A lot of advancements have been made in these land cover monitoring methods. And there is always a chance for improvement. Sometimes some a priori information is required for these land cover monitoring method. In case no a priori information is available about the trace site, then it is difficult to retrieve satisfactory result. Now let's see what are these land cover monitoring methods. So let's move on to the first method, which is target identification method or target decomposition method. As we discussed earlier, that the scattering obtained from one particular target is the combination of surface scattering, double bounce scattering, and the volume scattering. However, one type of scattering is dominant for one particular target. So if you want to obtain a separate scattering mechanism, then these decomposition techniques are used, which expresses the average mechanism as the sum of different scattering mechanisms. There are two types of polarimetric target decomposition methods. One is coherent method and another one is incoherent method. Coherent method is used for decomposition of single scatterers, and here we'll use the scattering matrix for decomposition. These types of targets decompositions are Pauli decomposition, Krogegger and Cameron decomposition. Incoherent decomposition is associated with decomposition of coherency or covariance matrix. So they are used for defining the scattering response from partial scatterers or the distributed scatterers. Two of the main categories of this incoherent target decomposition are eigenvalue decomposition and the model-based decomposition. We'll discuss in brief about model based decomposition method because they are widely used nowadays. Now let's see what is model based decomposition method. Model based decomposition method expresses the coherency or covariance matrix in as a summation of independent scattering mechanisms. The first decomposition method was developed by Freeman and Durden, which is known as three component scattering decomposition, and he decomposed the covariance matrix in three separate independent scatterings, which are double bounds, single bounds and the volume scattering. It was the plenary model based decomposition method, and it was effective for this composition of naturally distributed target but unable to distinguish between forest and man-made target, which are also a source of confusion because they have the same types of orientation and they give almost similar response, as we saw in Roorkee image, that they are giving same types of response in HV polarization. Both appears bright. FCSM. This is four component scattering decomposition method. It was developed by Professor Yamaguchi, and he introduced another term called helix scattering term as in three component decomposition method. And this helix scattering was associated to the scattering from urban area. And he considered the effect of rotation symmetry in this four component decomposition method, and it was effective decomposition for both naturally distributed targets and the man-made distributed target. Further, several modifications were done in four component decomposition methods, and till now seven component decomposition methods have been developed by various researchers. The further improvement was multiple component scattering decomposition, in which another term called wire scattering was introduced to define the scattering from linear objects. And this was also an effective decomposition method. And now let's see the three component and four component decomposition method. So Freeman models the covariance matrix, or coherency matrix could also be modeled as the contribution of three scattering mechanism, which is surface scattering, double bounce scattering and the volume scattering. Why this type of decomposition is important? Because all the scattering terms are defined on the basis of physical processes associated with targets. So this is the algorithm for some short algorithm shown here. It's a long algorithm. You can refer the paper TCM and FCM, in which the coherency matrix is represented in terms of surface scattering, double bounce scattering and the volume scattering. Here the volume scattering component was considered as the randomly oriented particles, and for which the volume scattering matrix was defined like this. And the power terms for surface, double and the volume scattering were obtained like this: Fs 1 plus beta, Fd 1 plus alpha square, Fb 4 of T3 3, this component, three component. And it this type of decomposition was unable to distinguish between forest and man-made targets. So in this three component decomposition technique, surface scattering was modeled by first order Bragg scattering, and double bounce was modeled by the considering two perpendicular surfaces having different electric constants, and volume scattering was modeled by considering randomly oriented uniform cylindrical objects. And the power terms are these that we obtain here. And the in four component decomposition method, it was considered that there was no reflection symmetry condition, and the fourth term which was added by the Professor Yamaguchi was the helix component, which was representing the scattering from man-made targets. And the power terms associated with surface, double and this helix scattering are represented by this. It was used for decomposition of both naturally distributed target and the man-made target. This is the result for three component decomposition, and these images represent the double bound scattering, volume scattering, and the single bound scattering. The RGB composite image of these TCM and FCM four component decomposition are shown here for Roorkee area. You see here that a three component decomposition shows green. This RGB composite image is generated by considering double bounce component as red, surface bounce as green, and volume as blue, and volume scattering as green. So green represents volume scattering. You see the urban area is representing a lot of green, means it is showing the dominant scattering mechanism, which is volume scattering. The blue portion is shown over here, which is a river which was dry at the time of acquisition. It is showing surface scattering. And the red portions are obtained somewhere here, here, here. Some dots are visible over here, which may be the trees or maybe due to some false classification. There are trees scattered over this city. That's why some red spots are also observed in this image. Now see the result for full four component decomposition, which is slightly different from three component decomposition. You see there are more red areas or pink areas appearing in this side of urban area, which is due to the fact that we have introduced helix scattering component here. And another improvement in this method was consideration of sinusoidal probability distribution function for volume scattering component. In three component decomposition technique, uniform probability distribution function was considered for describing the scattering for volume scattering component, while in this case FCM, the sinusoidal probability distribution function was also considered for describing the volume scattering. So the result is somewhat improved here in the FCM. However, the urban shows volume scattering here, which should be double bounce scattering, which is caused, which is a mis classification or misidentification. So the problem was resolved for these types of target by using the concept of deorientation. If you rotate the target about the radar line of sight, then this process is known as deorientation method. This process was required to be done before decomposition if you want to resolve these targets, these type of targets, correctly. So the model based decomposition methods before deorientation, the result is shown over here, where first the deorientation was performed and then the algorithm for TCM and FCM was applied as it is, as we did earlier. The results are shown over here, which are quite improved as compared to the earlier result. If you remember that in TCM method it was fully green, while if for deoriented image the result is quite improved here. Now next comes the classification methods. Next land cover monitoring method is the classification method. The intent of classification process is to categorize all the pixels in an image into one of the several land cover classes present within the satellite image. This categorized data may be used to produce thematic maps of land cover present in the image. So there are two types of classification method. One is parametric method, and another one is non-parametric method. In parametric classifier, what we do, we first estimate the statistical properties related to data first. And in non-parametric method, we do not estimate any statistical parameter prior to classification. So in parametric classifiers are of two types, supervised and unsupervised. Supervised polarized means we need to collect the samples to train or teach the classifier to determine the decision boundaries in the feature space, and such decision boundaries are significantly affected by the properties used to train the classifier. While an unsupervised classifier, what it does, it learns the characteristic of each class from the data itself. Supervised classifiers are of various types, in which we require to collect the training samples first. They are of they have various advantages and disadvantages too. The disadvantage of the supervised classifier is that the analyst imposes the classification structure upon the data by selecting the training areas, which may not truly represent the information class. However, the unsupervised classification also suffers from certain limitation. Sometimes the natural grouping obtained by the iterations in the classifier may not necessarily correspond nicely with the desired information class. So each classification method has their own advantages and disadvantages. So we have developed our own classification method, which is adaptive one, by making use of fully polarimetric system. It is the adaptive classification method, which makes use of statistical characteristics of polarimetric indices. What are polarimetric indices? They are derived parameters from the polarimetric data. The fully polarimetric data carries out information in the form of HH, HV, VV and VH, and we derive various other parameters from this polarimetric data, and this derived parameters or various R observables will be used for developing this algorithm. So this is the flowchart of this algorithm, in which first we'll extract the polarimetric indices, and then a criteria was used to select the best possible polarimetric index, which will be able to distinguish between two targets. Then statistical characteristics of those polarimetric indices will be measured in order to develop this adaptive algorithm, classification algorithm. So now let's see what are those polarimetric indices that will be used in this algorithm. These are backscattering coefficients and their ratios, weighted polarimetric sum, which is equal to 1000 SHH plus SHV VV raised to the power 0.001. It exhibits low value for smooth surface while high value for rough surface. Next is ratio vegetation index, which is the ratio of sigma HV divided by the summation of all the polarimetric scattering terms. It will give you higher value for diffuse scattering. Normalized difference polarization index, which is equal to SVV minus SVH divided by SVV plus SVH. It will give you higher value for rough surface. Cross polarization ratio, CPR, is equal to sigma HV divided by twice sigma HV plus sigma HH. It will discriminate between the bare and sparsely vegetated field. So our purpose here is to use multiple parameters. They will define different types of scattering from the land covers, and we have to select the best polarimetric index that will be able to discriminate the two land cover classes. Then we'll use the statistical characteristics, which are median and standard deviation, and create the mathematical expression for each of these polarimetric parameter to define the decision boundaries for discriminating the two targets here. And then this algorithm will be optimized to give you the unknown variable which will suits the user's need. So the criteria to select the best possible polarimetric index for separating two classes will be the separability index, which is defined as the आई माइनस म्यू जे डिवाइडेड बाई सिग्मा आई प्लस सिग्मा जे, वेयर म्यू आर द मीन ऑफ क्लास आई एन जे, वेयर सिग्मा इज द स्टैंडर्ड डेविएशन ऑफ द क्लास आई एन जे. How do you select the feature on the basis of the criteria of separability index? If Sij is greater than 2, then this will be considered as the best feature for separating two classes I and J. If Sij is less than 0.8, then it will be the worst feature for separation of two classes. So, based on the separability index criteria, the features that are obtained for these five classes, bare soil, water, short vegetation, urban and tall vegetation are these. Now, we cannot use all the parameters. So, we did some analysis and selected only best of the best features for our algorithm and created the mathematical expressions using standard deviation and the median of various polarimetric observables. After that, decision tree algorithm was developed by making use of those mathematical expressions for the best selected features for segregating various classes. This is the algorithm which we developed here, where m is the median and s is the standard deviation related to that particular polarimetric observable only. And we make use of these unknown terms in each of these expressions, which will be determined after the optimization of this algorithm. And we were able to achieve quite good accuracy with the help of this algorithm, which was 87.59% for N1, N2, N3 and N4 values of this. And this is the classified image of city Roorkee, in which red area shows the urban, bare soil is shown in yellow color, green is the short vegetation, tall vegetation is in cyan color, and some black spots are also there, which is misclassification. And the validation was also done on the same image, and the quite good results were obtained by using this method. Why we developed this method? Because if we would have used the fixed value of decision here, then it may happen if you use different kind of image or at different observation site, the value may be different for different images. So by using these type of mathematical expressions, we can adapt our algorithm for any kind of observation site. We don't need to create a new algorithm, we don't need to find new threshold, just we need to calculate the median and standard deviation of those particular polarimetric observable, and you need to optimize your algorithm by finding the value of N1, N2, N3 and N4, and just put those value in this algorithm, it will give you the classification result. There is no need to, once this algorithm is developed for one particular site, you don't need to collect the training samples, you don't need to go to do field visit. It will be applicable for that particular site if you have used this algorithm and calculated all the parameters here. So next, move on to another application, which is flood detection using SAR data. So flood detection is another application of SAR image. India is one of the country which is worst affected by flood after Bangladesh. In 2018, worst flood event occurred in Kerala region. This area was inundated deeply on 17th of August 2018. This is the image given by NRSC, in which blue areas represents the flooded regions in Kerala. Now let's see how this SAR data could be used for flood detection. This is the sentinel one image of the Kerala where flood event occurred in 2018, and this is the image of the date 4th April 2018. It is a reference image when there was no flood event. So we'll consider this particular area in our analysis to see the effect of flood in this SAR image. And we observed that this VV polarized was better for flood detection, and water is easily extractable by making use of this VV polarization. So this is the flood event was occurred on 17th of August, and the image for this particular region was available for 21 August and 27th August. So let's see what happened on the date 21st August. This is the just pre-processed image of VV and VH polarization of the Kerala region, and you see observed region, it is flooded. It is showing black spots here. Black spots here in VH polarization. It shows that there is certain moisture, or we could say the flooded region is existing over here. Now let's see the image of 27th August. When the water receded after some time, you see the VV polarization, the area, the earlier image is quite black, and this area in which somewhat the water has been receded on this particular day. So before starting this flood detection, first we need to mask the original water bodies in the this image. So this is the mask for the water body, original water body present in this particular image. So unmasked, for the unmasked image, the flood detection was carried out. The flooded areas that we observed used to show the low backscatter values. You can see the histogram scatter plot here, histogram plot here. And this is the image of analysis for 4th April 2018, which was the reference image, non-flooded reference image. You can observe the backscattering coefficients are minus 5 dB, minus 7 dB, minus 10 dB, while for the same areas for 21st August 2018 when flood was there, and 27th August 2018 when flood was there, the backscattering values are quite low for the same particular region. So this is the preliminary analysis, how you could observe the backscattering value for the flooded region. Now see, this was the Sentinel 2 image released by NASA on 22nd August 2018. Why we are not using the optical image for flooded flood detection? Because what happens when flood is occurring, there is a lot of rain, there will be a lot of cloud, so you will not be able to get the proper information about the flood from the optical data. You see there are a lot of clouds here, so you will not be able to observe to assess the actual situation, while by making use of this SAR data, which can work well in the rain and cloud, you can make use of SAR data for the flood detection, which would be helpful. If the satellite is providing you the data, it would be helpful to use SAR data for the flood detection. Now see, this is the image of 21st August in which the flooded region is shown in blue color, and after on 27th of August the water is receded after some time, because the rain is stopped after 22nd of August. This is the histogram analysis, on the basis of histogram analysis. So one parameter that is used for flood detection in the SAR image is normalized difference flood index, which is the ratio of normalized flood image and the reference image. It is the ratio of flood image minus reference image divided by flood plus reference image, and we determine the threshold for NDFI by taking the 75 percentile value of this parameter, and it was obtained as 0.7361. So pixel with less than 75 percentile has been considered for this threshold, and the flood map based on this NDFI threshold for Kerala region is shown here, which is overlaid on the Google Earth image of this Kerala region, and the blue color is showing the flooded region for 21st August 2018. We also determine the flood water depth for 21st August and 27th August, and you can see the for some of the regions that we selected for creating this plot, the flood depth is reduced in several areas, like in this region, for this region, for this region, the flood water was receded. Now next application is in lunar surface, and we'll show some result using mini SAR data which was on board Chandrayaan 1 satellite, which was sent by ISRO in 2008. The main purpose of this Chandrayaan 1 mission was to characterize the polar region of lunar surface and to find the possible evidences of water ice deposits in permanently shadowed regions of lunar surface. This mini SAR was hybrid polarimetric data in which the information was sent in left circular polarization, and reception was done in horizontal and vertical polarization. As we discussed earlier, that four bands are obtained from this hybrid polarimetric data, which are LH square, LV square, real of LHLV and imaginary of LHLV. This will give you the Stokes vector, which is equal to the summation of first two terms, this band 1 and band 2. S2 represent difference of band 1 and band 2. S3 is real part of LHLV, and S4 is minus of 2 imaginary LHLV. For this analysis, we selected MINISAR data of Peary crater, which is located in North Polar region, and this is S1 image of this Peary crater, and we'll show the result for this particular crater for our developed algorithm. After calculating the Stokes parameter, several child parameters were extracted from this MINISAR data, which are degree of polarization, which is equal to second, third and fourth square summation of these Stokes parameter divided by S1. The low value of degree of polarization will give you volume scattering, while the high value of degree of polarization will represent either surface scattering or the double bound scattering. Another parameter, which is very important parameter from the point of view of water ice detection, is circular polarization ratio, which is equal to S1 minus S4 divided by S1 plus S4. It has been found by various researchers that this high value of CPR is associated with planetary water ice deposits, and there was also confusion related to this parameter, that the high value of CPR was also representing higher roughness. So this was the confusion. We know that this parameter helps in detection of water ice deposit, however this will also represent the rough surface. So how do we resolve this ambiguity? Let's see. Another parameter is relative LHLV phase difference, which is equal to minus S4 by S3. This value close to minus 90 represents surface scattering, close to plus 90 represents double bounce scattering, and the distributed value of this delta will represent the volume scattering. So what was happening over here, that high CPR was obtained by the साइज एंड वॉल्यूम स्कैटरिंग. हाउएवर इफ द सर्फेस इज रॉकी, हैव लावा फ्लोज और वेरियस रॉक्स लाइंग ओवर द सर्फेस, देन द सेम रिटर्न विल बी सेम टाइप ऑफ पोलराइजेशन विल बी रिटर्न टूवर्ड्स द रडार. सो द CPR दैट इज सेम सेंस पोलराइजेशन विल बी इंक्रीज. सो हाउ टू रिजॉल्व दिस केस, इफ एनी हाउ वी वुड बी एबल टू कैलकुलेट द टेक्सचरल इंफॉर्मेशन और रफनेस इंफॉर्मेशन, वी कुड रिजॉल्व दिस एम्बिग्यूटी. सो फॉर दिस पर्पज इन आर रिसर्च वर्क वी मेक यूज ऑफ द फ्रैक्टल एनालिसिस. बाई फ्रैक्टल एनालिसिस वी कैलकुलेटेड फर्स्ट द फ्रैक्टल डायमेंशन विच डिफाइंस द सर्फेस ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ इट्स रफनेस. Also, what we could do here that these ice deposit will represent the volume scattering. So, low value of m will give you volume scattering, and the delta value, which is randomly distributed, will give you the volume scattering. So, low value of delta, high value of CPR, and distributed delta value, if it will happen inside the crater, will be indicative of the possible water rise, if we could resolve the ambiguity related to roughness. So first we calculated the fractal dimension, which is the measure of complexity and irregularity of the surface, and it is used to represent the roughness of the surface. The value of this fractal dimension can vary between 2 to 3. Higher the value of d, higher will be the surface roughness, and we calculated the value of d with the help of one of the method, which is triangular prism surface area method, which is this. I am not going to explain it here. So on the basis of all the postulates which we discussed here, that if we could able to remove the surface scattering, double bounce scattering, and the rough surface analysis, whatever region will be left for high CPR and the low value of m will give you the possible water ice particles within the lunar surface or within the crater. So this algorithm was developed by us. First we remove the all the surface scattering component by taking the value of delta close to minus 90, and plus 90 will give you double bounce scattering, sorry, minus 9, and this d represents the fractal dimension. Its value less than certain value, which is the mean value of the fractal dimension, which was obtained as 2.17. If d is less than this value, it will give you the smooth region, and if CPR is high in the smooth region, if there may be a possibility of water ice deposits on the lunar surface. So this is the result of our proposed algorithm on Peary crater. These red dots are overlaid over S1 image of this Peary crater, and these red dots are showing the possible water ice deposits within the crater region. And we are also working on this Chandrayaan 2 data, and hopefully we'll have another paper related to this in near future. And there are several other applications related to SAR polarimetry. You can find their application in estimation of soil moisture, the application of drought detection for roughness estimation, etc. So let's close it here. Thank you so much.